6 arrives.
Oh,
sing with us on this day. Lamb of God.
62 in the black binder here. It's called the Hallelujah Songbook, number 62. Well, here you go.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Sunday. Welcome to those joining us online as well. It's wonderful to be in worship and see so many familiar and so many new faces. And we're not going to do what we normally do, where we ask all the visitors to stand up, because that might just take the entire worship. But it is wonderful to see so many faces, to see all of you here. And as we like to say in every week of worship, that no matter where you've been on your journey of faith and in this life, you are welcome here. This is your church, and we are blessed by your presence here today. So thank you for joining us for worship today. I want to extend an invitation, though, even though we won't maybe do some of the parts, I still want to take a moment just to rise up, because on Resurrection Sunday, we have to rise up as many times as possible. And I would like to invite you to take that opportunity, and as you are comfortable, to turn and to greet your neighbor and bless one another in the light and the love of Christ. So take a moment to stand up and greet one another.
Yeah.
Love those sounds of joy and greeting and community happening. So I would like to invite you into a time of announcement and prayer. I have a few things that I'd like to share still. So if you just please join me in a spirit of prayerful attention at this time. First thing I'd like to share is that after our worship today, immediately after, if you are a family with a youngster, maybe someone who's fifth grade or less, under fifth grade, and you'd like to participate in our special Easter egg hunt, then you can just go out the sanctuary doors and just turn to the right. You'll see a sign in the breezeway that says Pilgrim Hall. Go there and you will receive all the instruction that you need. And also, I've been told to say that the youth group members, so anyone who is, sixth grade and older, please meet in Pilgrim Hall during the service. You have special egg duty. anything else I missed there? I think that's it. I want to ask if Emma Bellis, one of our youth group members, would come up. She has a special announcement to share this morning.
All right, hi, my name is Emma Bellis. As Dan said, I am a member of this church's youth group, and we are putting together a little food-a-palooza for the benefit of the AIFC's, Auburn International Faith Food Closet, Rock Creek Food Drive. It'll be on May 1st after the church service, as opposed to mix and mingle. On the deck behind Pilgrim Hall, we will have food, drinks, games, and music. We will have a little barbecue, burgers, hot dogs, chips, and a drink. All of that for about like $5. You can get yourself a nice little lunch. And we will also be having a bake sale where I, as well as other youth, will have lots of yummy baked goods that we will bring and sell to you all. And once again, all proceeds will go directly to the Rock Creek Food Drive. There will be flyers that we will be handing out in the back there. He has a flyer. After the church service today, so yeah.
Great job, Emma. Thank you. So May 1st after worship, there's she's got work to do. Okay, she's not just come back for the sermon. The yellow sheets at the back have more information about that. But May 1st, and as she said, all the proceeds go to support this church's ongoing collaborative effort with Auburn Presbyterian Church that we do each month to support the Rock Creek School with our food drive. So that's wonderful. Thank you for that. A birdie told me that it is certain Stephen Mahalik's birthday today. So I do want to wish Stephen a happy 85th birthday, is that true? But congratulations. Still here, amen to that. We're so thankful. I want to say that there will be a celebration of life this coming Friday for one of our dear church members who passed recently, Josh Wilson. It's at 10 a.m. Friday in the sanctuary, so if you're available to come, all are welcome to attend that. And then the last thing I have on my list this morning is we want to lift up special prayers for Ellen Bond, who is now home and on hospice, and also for Wilma Guido, who is also on hospice. So we just want to keep them in our prayers and their loved ones as well. If you would please continue in the spirit. Oh, Barbara, did you have something to add?
There's also mix and mingle after.
Oh, thank you. So those that are not doing maybe the Easter egg hunt afterwards, go all the way down and continue to pilgrim to Overmiller Hall, and you'll find refreshments and coffee and other great times so we can be in fellowship and community together after church as well. Thank you for that reminder.
There's also an 80th birthday.
Who's, what? Yes, please, do share. Oh, it is Jim. Okay, well, congratulations. So it's just happening everywhere. Happy 80th birthday. Why not? Is there anyone else? Do I see 90? Do I have 90?
It's my
65. This is a popular day to be born. Well, amen, and congratulations to all of you.
Happy birthday, Mike.
Please, let's continue in the spirit of prayer with a moment of silence, a time of silence. And if you feel moved to call out someone's name or another joy or concern, you're welcome to do so. And then I'll close us with a pastoral prayer and we'll say the Lord's Prayer together. God, on days like this, we are reminded about the precious gift of life and of renewal of life, especially in those often difficult places where we may not see it coming. God, for all of us here today that have been going through challenging days, walking through difficult chapters, we ask that the message and meaning of Easter might fill us with a profound sense of hope, even in the midst of trials, that there is a dawn to follow the setting sun. And God, for those of us that are just feeling joyful and exuberant today, may this space here be a place that allows that to happen, whether it's children or whether it's your 85th birthday. May each one of us feel permission to just be fully who we are here in this place, that our worship might express the whole range of our humanity with you. God, the space for worship is one that is both a real community and a symbol of what community can be. And so we pray that on these types of days, when it feels so rich and lively and full, may it continue to grow within each one of us, that this spirit of life and possibility and resurrection might be known in our own lives and all around us this day and each day to come. God, we praise you and we thank you for the gifts of faith and of community. And we pray these words together now as we seek to walk in union with you and one another. Let us say now the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I invite everyone to rise as you are able and find your blue hymnal and turn to number 476. We'll sing Jesus Christ is Risen Today.
Let's sing verses 1, 2, and 5.
Verses 1, 2, and 5 we will sing. Thank you.
Oh,
to worship. Your portion is in the bowl. Think of a moment when someone that you least expected to see suddenly stands before you.
A moment when something we had lost is found again, and we can scarcely believe our eyes.
Think of a moment when your fear was suddenly proved unfounded, and you were surprised by joy.
This morning is such a moment. We resign ourselves to the worst, and suddenly life turns around.
So come this Easter morning to be shaken from your conviction that nothing can change your situation.
We come as ones who look at the world and feel overwhelmed by its chaos, disillusioned by its promises.
On this morning, we remember how Mary went to anoint a corpse and was greeted by a Savior.
In this place, may we too see our lives and the world through new eyes.
For Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Amen.
You may be seated.
Our scripture today is from John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out and went to the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet, they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, 'I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God.'" Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that she had said these things, that he had said these things to her. May God bless this reading and our understanding of it.
Would you please be with me in the spirit of prayer? Holy One, in this space of shared word and received message, may it be your spirit of love that guides what I say and do, and that prepares the heart soil of each one here to not only receive it, but to help the seeds of what is heard bear great fruit in your name and in your way. Amen. So I have relatives on my dad's side who are from the South. I mean, at least that part of Maryland that has a particularly Southern way about it. And when we'd go visit my cousins down there, especially my uncle would always sort of say, you know, things are a little different down here than, you know, you New Englanders, the way you handle your business up there. And basically, he kind of informed me that down there, you know, we all know our place. Okay, talk to me about knowing our place. And what I learned quickly about what that means, at least for me as a kid, was that knowing my place means that I tended to talk too much, and that he would like to remind me of that fact. So, as a kid, he would basically try to insist that I be still and obedient when he needed me to be. And I remember that playing out in so many different ways. I mean, we would go to a church once in a while, you know, Catholic church there. And if I was talking to my sister, I mean, I might be whispering. We might have even been talking about the sermon. But he would pinch me if I was talking. And I said, don't you forget your place. Now, I wonder what my uncle would have thought about all of you making all that noise when you greeted each other this morning. You would have got a lot of pinching. But nonetheless, it seemed to me then, and it still strikes me now, as a bit of a rigid way of thinking, you know. But I understand where it comes from. But I also want to say that this idea of knowing our place isn't just about the way we talk. I remember a friend of mine, a neighbor, in growing up in New Hampshire, and her name was Kim. And when we were about 8 or 9, we played catch. You played catch with any kids you could find in the neighborhood. It was baseball catch. I was in Little League at the time. But I remember she really wanted to be in Little League too. And this was at the time, late 70s, early 80s, when it wasn't really a thing for girls to play Little League. But Kim and her parents really wanted to play. And so they pressed it. And, you know, eventually she was allowed to play in Little League. But what I remember is that I heard various people at the games sort of expressing in one way or another that that Kim was perhaps forgetting her place in this. In that same area, there was a train track that separated the town of Hudson from Nashua, where some other cousins lived. And you probably grew up in towns like this, too, where it's not just an expression, you know, when we say the other side of the tracks. Some of these communities, you know, if you have a certain level of means or something, you live on one side of the track, and then other people live on the other side of the track. And that's what was true in this case as well. And if you lived on one side, you were sort of expected, well, I guess either side, you had an understanding of what was expected of you. Even though we never really talked about it, you just sort of knew. It was there. You all knew your place relative to it. And what I want to say in bringing up these few examples is this type of thing isn't something that just pertains to the South. It doesn't just pertain to rural New England. And truthfully, it doesn't just pertain to the past. There have always been unwritten rules and dividing lines and resistance to those who dare to step over them. And throughout history, time and again, when someone has sort of forgotten their place, at least in the eyes of the people with power, there have often been heavy consequences. Jesus would have been one who knew about that. He was a Jewish man living where the Roman Empire controlled everything. He wasn't a Roman citizen, and so he had very few, if any, rights. And even in his own community, he didn't really have any standing. He was just the son of a carpenter, so really no money, no power. But it was when he started teaching, it's when he started his ministry, that's when things got a little dangerous. He was teaching these crowds, some might even say indoctrinating them. He was healing people. He was being talked about like a new king. And that was dangerous, because there he was, this man who's showing the Romans and the religious authorities and anyone in power that, oh, yes, he had forgotten his place, seemingly flaunting it even. And so they decided to remind him. They arrested him and convicted him and sentenced him to die by crucifixion, which you may or may not know was primarily reserved for non-Roman citizens. Oh yes, crucifixion was used very rarely on Roman citizens, but primarily for non-Roman citizens. So what I'm saying is, even in the way they chose this crucifixion, even the punishment they chose, they were trying to put Jesus in his place. And as that tomb was sealed, it seemed for all to see that they had succeeded. And that right there is the story of Good Friday. And I get it. It's pretty grim. And some of you came here today like, well, I'm not really wanting to hear that story today. But the truth is, it's a story we hear every day. That's because this world, while I don't agree with those that say it's a bad place, it's an evil place, it's not that, but it's a badly broken place, yes. And it's filled with pain and suffering and war and violence abound, hatred and injustice. And if you just listen too much to those stories of the world that surrounds us, you might actually believe that this is how it's supposed to be. You might believe that there's just nothing you can really do to change it either. Or if you think about it another way, you might know, your place in it. And it's not surprising to approach it that way, because the truth is, if you're going to be realistic and live in the world, you sort of have to know what your place is. You know what surrounds you. You have to be aware of these things. But you don't have to necessarily accept it. Okay? You can see it, you can be aware of it, but you don't have to accept it. You don't have to accept your place in the whole thing. It's not mandatory to do that. We might live in a Good Friday world. We don't have to have a Good Friday faith. Okay? We don't have to accept our place as passive in what's happening in and around us all the time. And that's especially true based on what we just heard in our scripture today. On this first day of the Sabbath, which is what her first opportunity would have been, Mary goes to Jesus' tomb. But when she gets there, The stone that was supposed to be sealing him in has been rolled away, and Jesus is nowhere to be found. Okay, we know this. And so Mary goes and is flustered and desperate, probably. And she goes and finds, and the first one she sees is this gardener. And she's asking him, where's Jesus? What happened? And in that moment, even the possibility that he might have risen is so far-fetched. It's so far gone, it's so unbelievable, that at first she didn't even realize that the very person she's talking to is Jesus. So even Mary, who you could argue is his most devoted follower, couldn't believe that somehow Jesus would not simply accept his place and stay put where they had left him. That's the good news of Easter, really. That's the good news right there. When the world told Jesus that he had forgotten his place and tried to put him in his place, he then comes back and shows them that he does indeed know his place, and it's not in any tomb. And that good news still matters today. Because for all the ways that our world tries to extinguish hope and put God's love back in various tombs, you know what happens? It just doesn't stay put. God's love never stays put. It's true no matter what. Even in our world that's dominated by so much injustice and narcissism and self-interest and cultures where so many of us are either looking out for ourselves or people that are just like us, Jesus reminds us that that is not at all who we're supposed to be. Amen. That's not real life. That's not real wholeness. And that's not real hope. In other words, that's not our real place. And I believe at some level that we all know that. We're here today because at some level we believe that there's a better way. We believe that just as Jesus was risen 2,000 years ago, he's still risen today. And because of that, we are learning what our real place in this world looks like. One of the best examples that I can think of courage, and there's so many, but the stories of those young African-American students in the 1960s who tried to integrate all the lunch counters across the South. You remember the stories. Maybe some of you lived them. You certainly saw the videos. It's profound. They would enter these restaurants and stage sit-ins and be so still in the face of relentless, you know, verbal attacks, taunts, violence. And they were often accused, if you remember, of what? Forgetting their place, right? It's not your place to be here. But those accusations, as we've come to find out, were just wrong. They did know their place. And it was sitting right there, those counters. And so many of the people that participated in those sit-ins, they were infused by their faith. And they saw the story of Jesus and they believed in him and what he went through. And that just as he knew his rightful place and so stepped out of the places of death and rose again, they trusted that and they took strength from a faith that would teach them where they would rise to a new place too. That's an Easter faith right there. That's Easter faith. It's a faith that says no to the lies and the hatred and the violence and the fear and the bigotry. It's a faith that teaches us where our real place is. And that is, it's one that raises us up with Christ as it raises others up too. And as I've said many years now, I've been here 10, I feel like I say this every Easter. But Easter is not a one-time event that happened 2,000 years ago. Easter still happens every day all around us. Because Christ triumphed over death all those years ago, we are now able to rise and face a whole new set of tombs as they make themselves known before us. And in that, the Easter story still lives on. It does so when someone who's an addict decides to lay down their addiction and choose to live. It lives on when a gay kid who's been bullied for years refuses to believe that they are anything less than God's beloved. It lives on when we start to cross those lines that are drawn by fear and extend our hands, open up to those who, especially at first glance, seem like we have nothing in common with. That's what it is. It also lives on in this way. It lives on when we forget our place, at least the place that the world often tells us about, right? The Easter story lives on when we start singing out the kind of faith that says that no living person's true place is to be in any kind of figurative or literal tomb in this world. Once again, that's the good news of Easter. But I also say that's the easy part. That's the easy part because there's a challenge. You know, if you know anything about the Bible, you know anytime there's good news, there's a challenge to go with it. That's the deal. And the challenge is this. If this empty tomb story is reminding us that Jesus doesn't quite stay put where we stick him, then neither can we. After all, Mary went looking for him just a few days after he was supposed to be sealed up and done, ultimate end, right there. And she found that he wasn't where they'd put him. So that was only 3 days later. Now, 2,000 years later, where is Jesus? Where is he now? What's he up to? What's he want us to be up to? That's the important question. That's the big question right there. Each of us needs to figure out, to find out, what is holding us back in those old places, those old tombs? Where are we stuck in them still? How can we remember our real places in this world. And you know, for each one of us, it's going to look a little different. Can't tell you where yours is going to be exactly, but I can say this. Wherever it is, you will see light and life, and you will feel more connection to who you truly are than maybe any time before in your life. Okay? You'll be more fully yourself. But we don't stop there, because our job is then to take that light and bring it out to the world, to remind others of their true place as well. So find it for ourselves, yes. Step out of the tombs, yes. And then help others do the same. Because their place is as beloved children of God too. And their place is as ones for whom Christ also rose. It's not just for us. Their place is as people who don't belong in the tombs either, but they belong in the light. And speaking and being that truth, that right there is the work of Easter. That's the challenge. So together, and it doesn't matter if this is your first time here, or if you only come a couple times a year, or if you come every week, this is the work that we all are charged to do together. Okay? And as we seek to follow Jesus, who's the one that for our own good just never seems to stay put anywhere, may we learn also, like he showed us, to forget our place, at least the ones that the world tells us about, the ones that the world tells us to accept. And may we guide one another with this light of Christ out of those places of the tombs, out of those, and then on to a truer place than maybe we have ever known. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. For some, it's easy to believe. For others, it's just silly. But for most, we wonder. We wonder what might be possible. And God, if love is the greatest power in the universe, we wonder what might be possible. If love chooses to carry on loving, even those who try and kill it, what might be possible? And if love decides to give of itself for the sake of others, what might be possible? So, in our wonder and our longing for such a love as this that changes things, may we dare to believe in what seems impossible, and dare to live impossible lives that hope beyond death, but believe in life before death. May we live this kind of love that dares to work for justice and the fullness of life for everyone, dares to work for peace and the fullness of peace for everyone, because we believe in love, which has become the most powerful thing in the universe, because it gives of itself. God, may we take time in this season of renewal and life to wonder and wonder what love might make possible in us. For Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen.
Amen.
friends, before we leave the sanctuary, I just want to remind everyone there are offering plates at the back. If you brought something that you would like to give today, we so appreciate your ongoing generosity. And now please be with me in a spirit of prayer as we ready ourselves to go back into our lives and our world. God, may this message of resurrection be one that stays within us, that guides how we talk and how we move and act in this world. Help us to rise up to our real place with you and lift up, reach out our hand to lift up others that they might find their place as well. And God, as each one of us does that, the resurrection life will be real now. So God, we praise you for the new life that you offer, and we ask for the courage to embrace it and live into it. Go now, friends. Go now and be the light of Christ in this life. Amen.
Amen. Amen.